So it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Kristen Matthews, who's an associate professor of English, to introduce Rachel Kirkwood.
Okay, good morning. It's with great pleasure that I get to introduce Rachel today. Rachel received her BA in English with a minor in Women's Studies from BYU in 2012. While at BYU, she was involved in the English Society and the leadership there, helping to organize the English Symposium when it was in its infancy, reading for and publishing in Criterion, and working as a writing fellow. She's currently a fifth-year PhD student in English at Stanford University. While a graduate student, she's helped run and organize the Interdisciplinary Perspectives on the Contemporary group. She's taught writing and rhetoric at Stanford, and she's taught world humanities at City College of New York. Her research focuses primarily on post-1945 American lit, with specific interests in autobiographical fiction, literary history, and authorial celebrity. Her dissertation examines the intersection of contemporary Anglophone autofiction and genres of suspense in the late 20th and early 21st century. Now, on a more personal note, I got to know Rachel when she was a student of mine in a couple of classes here at BYU. And I was struck by her energy, her curiosity, and her humor. I was also impressed by her intellectual generosity inside of the classroom and outside of the classroom. Inside class, Rachel was always there kind of motivating others to kind of up their game and how they were thinking about things, but doing so in a way that wasn't condescending or sort of that person at English Society parties you want to smack, right? She was really good at it. We also had lots of lively conversations outside of class in my office. But perhaps the liveliest of conversations I had was a debate that she, I, and our women's lit class had over the merits and problems of the show What Not to Wear. And I won't say who argued for what position. I'll just kind of leave that out there. But I can say that Rachel Kirkwood is an electric mind and a kind soul, and I'm happy to call her a BYU alumna and a friend. So please join me in welcoming her.
Oh, thank you for that really wonderful introduction. Obviously, we're on the same wavelength because there's a couple of repeats in what I'm going to say. So there we go. All right, so I was invited here. Why are all of you here? If you're sitting in this room, you're probably a college student and you're studying English or thinking about it. Maybe you get extra credit for coming to this talk or get to count it as a class. I know the thing. That or you're related to me. Those seem like the two most viable options. Either way, chances are we have some things in common. You like to read, you like to write, you would be an asset in a Harry Potter trivia competition. This is taken last month. We were so close to a perfect score, by the way. You may have been the sole reason page limits were ever specified in high school English classes. A belated apology to Mr. Morris for the 35-page freshman English paper on the Count of Monte Cristo. And like me, here at BYU, you may have seen Phil Snyder jumping up and down during the kiss scene from Pride and Prejudice. Or maybe you've heard Matt Wickman describe how Scotland did literally everything before the rest of the world, or at least better. We just don't know about it. And you've probably had passionate arguments about gender politics or makeover shows, or really of anything, with Kristen Matthews. But you and I are different in at least one way. While you are still making up your minds about what to do after you graduate, I decided to spend 6 more years in college and pursue a PhD in English literature. Therefore, some of you may reason, the main difference between us is that I am insane and you are not. And believe me, I have moments of thinking that too. In my junior year here, Dr. Wickman advised me and a group of other would-be academics in the Future Scholars Program that, and I quote, "You should not go to graduate school if you can imagine yourself being happy doing literally anything else." Literally everything else, those were his words. And it's sage advice, which I took seriously, and just as seriously discarded. Sure, going through a 6-year program after graduating isn't a cakewalk, and the academic job market isn't what it used to be. once you have your degree, there may be only one or two jobs in the entire United States calling for your specific specialty in a given year, and you might not get either of them. But surely these are problems for someone else, not for someone with as much drive, determination, and pure intellectual energy as Rachel Kirkwood. So, literary academia was what I was born to do. I knew this in my bones, so I went forth undaunted. And here I am, a good ways through a PhD program, and I've come back to explain a little bit about my educational and professional journey, along the way dispensing some advice that you'll most likely throw away, as I did Dr. Wickman's. So, part one, English. So, what are you going to do with that? As I alluded to before, for me, majoring in English was a no-brainer. Reading and writing came naturally to me. As a child, I loved to inhabit the worlds of books and sometimes fell asleep in them. Oh, look how cute. And the more I learned, the more I came to crave the sense of mastery that analyzing a text can provide. This passion only increased in college. In high school, I had been taught how to analyze a book or poem for thematic content, supporting my assertions with meaty quotes and identifications of literary devices. But it wasn't until college that I learned about literary theory, that I realized that there were not only multiple possible interpretations of a given text, but multiple possible methods for interpreting a text. I found out that what I had been naturalized into in K through 12 was a new critical interpretive practice. Who knew? At BYU, I learned how to be cognizant of these frames and to carefully choose how I approach each text rather than simply going through the list of steps I had been taught. I was so nerdily excited. So the question for me wasn't why English. I loved the feeling of expanding your worldview, the marriage of intellectual inquiry and aesthetic pleasure, and the concrete skills of argumentation and cogent self-expression that the discipline provided. The only question for me was something I'm sure every English major has been asked since the dawn of time. So what are you going to do with that? And it appeared to me that there was a set list of options. First, law school, AKA selling out. It has its attractions. It provides at least the illusion of a high-powered career, sleek pantsuits and no-nonsense ponytails, and theoretically offers the ability to intervene in matters of social justice. But it also has its negatives. The high price tag, which effectually turns you into an indentured servant for a law firm, for one, and simply put, the lack of novels. It's ultimately this last reason that turned me away from becoming a lawyer. I wanted to do something creative, or at least something adjacent to the arts. Well, that and the fact that as I'm a very passionate and sometimes outspoken person, I realized that I would probably spend the bulk of my career in jail for contempt of the court, so there's that also. So, on to the next option. Writer. What could be more creative than writing? Living off your sheer imagination. I could be a novelist. But only the most popular authors even make a living wage from their writing nowadays. If it's true, read MFA versus NYC if you don't believe me. I could be a freelance columnist, but the constant deadlines, and I'm much too verbose. I could be a screenwriter, but I'm too shy to just put my writing out there to be found, and too proud to go down to LA and prostrate myself at the feet of Hollywood executives. Altogether, writing as a career seemed to be too much pressure on my creative output, a product about which I was already completely insecure to begin with. But academia, you might not be writing stories, but at least you get to write about stories. So I considered becoming a professor. After all, you get to talk about ideas all day long, help to shape young minds without having to deal with the madness that is high school classroom management. And if you do it right and make it into a top school, you could get a funding package and make it through grad school without any debt. Take that, lawyers. But a PhD takes so long. The academic job market is wretched, and you have to write papers for the rest of your life. But plus, there's the unspoken worry, what if I'm just not smart enough? So what's similar to that, but perhaps more attainable? Teaching high school. I'd always cared deeply about education, and people often told me growing up that I seemed like I would be a good teacher. And teachers are needed everywhere, so I could probably get a job wherever I moved. And I still get to talk about books. Okay, let's do that. So I settled on high school teaching. I applied to the program the beginning of my sophomore year and started the secondary education major that winter. I took introductory courses in adolescent development, how to make your teaching accessible for students with accommodations, built a unit around my favorite YA novel, barring Harry Potter, Susan Cooper's King of Shadows, and I spent more than 70 hours observing and volunteering in middle and high school English classrooms. I was well on my way. But I'm not a high school English teacher. So what happened to that plan? Oh, there we go. Phil. Phil Snyder happened. This picture is courtesy of your son, Jack. He might not even remember this, but at the end of my first quarter of the teaching program, I went into Dr. Snyder's to interview to be his TA. He asked me three questions. First, why English? I told him the answer I've already told you, and he seemed satisfied. Second, why high school? He apparently wasn't convinced by my answer here, as he proceeded to tell me in no uncertain terms that I obviously needed to go to graduate school and get a PhD, and outlined everything I should do in the next 2 years to make that happen. Once his monologue was over, he posed his last query. Any questions about the job? No, not about the TA job, Phil, but about my life, yes. So what he said struck a chord with me, because the entire time I was studying education, I kept thinking, is this it? Is this what I worked my entire neurotically perfectionistic life for, to go back to high school? Even though I've always felt a deep commitment to the goals of public education and loved my pedagogy classes, the low status teaching holds in society got to me. I was an ambitious person, and when I told people that I was studying secondary ed, I could almost physically see them write me off. Oh, what a typical BYU major to prepare for a nice mom job, their looks seemed to say. And that infuriated me. It made me angry that teaching isn't a highly respected profession, despite its vast importance to society. It made me angry that the difficulty of developing effective pedagogical practices isn't acknowledged. It made me angry that I was angry about being associated with mom jobs and that people refer to them as such, because there's nothing wrong with a flexible career that makes time for a family or work-life balance. But most of all, I was angry because of my major, all my hard work and ambition was simply not recognized. So what Phil had said tapped into these insecurities and my performative rage against the machine. I wanted to prove myself capable. Plus, and it's hard to emphasize how important this was, he seemed to think that I was capable. And that was all it took. I went home that day and rewrote the plan for my future. I had just needed one little nudge, one person to say, think about a different option, for me to go after what I initially rejected out of fear. So, what did I do to prepare? I immediately threw myself into preparing for grad school, because when I am in, boy, I am in. Go big or go home has always been my philosophy, for better or worse. I researched schools in a Hermione-esque fashion, lists, spreadsheets, the works. I took the Future Scholars Program course with Dr. Wickman to get advice on the application process. As a result, I worked to develop a specific scholarly interest that I could assert so that I could assert what my area of focus would be in graduate applications. And I started an ambitious project that I could hone to serve as my writing sample. I also formed a study group of like-minded English word nerds for the verbal section of the GRE, the only part that literature programs usually care about, by the way. I know someone who skipped the math sections entirely, though I would not recommend that. I studied for and took the GRE subject test in literature, and after I felt proficient in French, I studied a little bit of Italian in order to prepare for the language requirements of most programs. And of course, I became involved in almost everything vaguely connected to literature on campus. I worked as a writing fellow and a TA. Phil gave me the job, by the way. And I published papers on J.D. Salinger and Thomas Pynchon in Americana and Criterion. I also worked as a reader for Criterion, not the same year that my paper was published, no conflict of interest. And I was in the leadership for the English Society, as Krista Matthews has mentioned, recruiting unsuspecting freshmen at club fairs and hosting departmental Edgar Allan Poe-themed Halloween parties. Pictured here is me stabbing Paul Westover during the Poe skit competition. I'm obviously very committed to my craft. And I helped to organize the symposium at which I spoke my final 2 years. So to put it short, I did all the things that I could think of. The list is so long that it bores even me hearing it now, but at the time, I really loved it. And I had amazing professors who were great mentors to me, many of whom I've mentioned, Dr. Snyder, Dr. Matthews, Dr. Wickman, and Dr. Westover, being just a few of them. So I applied to graduate school's fall semester of my senior year, many, many programs, and I waited. After a minor emotional breakdown in early February, which started with me lamenting all of the question marks that was my future, and ended with me railing against the slipping standards of artistic achievement, as evident in the fact that Hugo, the mediocre love letter to Hollywood from Hollywood, was nominated for 11 Academy Awards, my sister told me that is something you should cross off your list of worries. I finally heard back from schools. I was rejected by some, accepted by others, went out for admit visits, and chose Stanford. Not only because it almost always has perfect weather, partially due to the drought, which is now over, sadly, but also, I guess it's good. But also because on its faculty were some of the most innovative professors in my particular field, and I couldn't wait to work with them. So, on to grad school, part two. Free food and existential crises, the pros and cons of grad school. Each person's time in graduate school is singularly idiosyncratic, as the intellectual climate of the university you attend, the drama of the relationships between members of your particular department, the personality and dedication of your advisor, and the seminar topics offered during your coursework combine into a matrix of difference that produces a very individualized experience. That said, the basic structure of a PhD is relatively similar across the board, and I think it would be useful to go into a bit here, as I only figured it out by lots of reading online. All right, so first you do 2 years of coursework, more or less, taking literature seminars for which you read thousands of pages a week, typically at least one novel and some criticism for each of your three classes. Give presentations, write short response papers, and produce final research papers of around 20 pages. Stanford's on the quarter system, and so we have a slightly shorter amount of time to produce papers, so they might be a little bit shorter than programs on the semesters, but yeah, the quarter system is terrible. Everyone knows it, but we soldier on. So after coursework, you take a qualifying comprehensive exam on all of literary history, proving that you know something about everything and can make broad connections across time and genre. At Stanford, this took the form of a 1-hour oral examination by three professors, each quizzing you on their specialty. Perhaps the strangest question on my exam was, compare Richard Wright, an African-American 20th century novelist, to William Wordsworth, a white English 19th century poet. But somehow I did it. And moved on. So after coursework and the exam, at this point you're usually expected to have demonstrated reading proficiency in two foreign languages through tests or classes in order to be less reliant on translations of critical work. I took an exam in French my first week there and to test out, and in my third year I took an Italian reading course, of which I ended up being the only student. So I spent a few hours a week with an intense Italian woman putting passages in front of me to orally translate on the spot to see what you can do. Molto difficile, but fun. And yeah, it was something. And then, but after that, you take your orals exam. So following coursework and orals, you spend up to a year doing independent study for your orals exam, for which you prepare a corpus of texts, around 100 from a specific time period and oriented around a governing principle that interests you. It's basically quals, but specialized. Mine was authorship and authority in 20th and 21st century American literature. You then gather a faculty committee of your choice together in a room. You give a short presentation, and the committee members grill you on one by one for 3 hours. This is meant to be a sort of jumping off point for developing a dissertation topic. Landing on this golden topic can be very frustrating. When I came to grad school, I thought that I knew the broad subject that I would focus, that would be the focus of my dissertation, academic satire and paranoid reading. I had worked on it in undergrad, and I knew that there was more to be done, and I was excited and impatient to get past coursework to do my research. But guess what? You actually learn things in grad school. Go figure. As you find projects that interest you for your classes, participate in or start supplemental reading groups, workshops, or research groups, and seek out and attend conferences centered on your field, you develop sharper writing skills and gain a broader understanding of the academic landscape, which comes to inform your research decisions. So, with detours into 9/11 fiction, the historical novel, travel literature, and posthumanism, I ended up moving from academic satire to metafiction, to books about authorship, to autobiographical fiction, to autofiction, which is the subject of my dissertation now. From my perspective now, the end result seems inevitable and obvious, but I couldn't have jumped to my idea in its current formulation from the beginning. Projects take time to develop and grow palimpsestically layer upon layer. The end goals of graduate school are to be well-read across time periods and various schools of criticism, to develop clarity, organization, and profundity in your writing and speaking, to form a scholarly identity, craft an original project, and produce original research. Something that has become clear to me over the last 5 years is that developing these skills of thinking cannot be done through hard work or force of will alone. It also takes time, obnoxiously. So, what do you do once you've passed orals and come up with that idea worth writing about? You start your dissertation. First, you write a proposal outlining your project, and then you work on the thing itself, a document that typically runs around 4 chapters, each at least 50 pages long, which examine a central question from a variety of angles. And I won't go into what mine is now, because we mentioned it earlier. Then, once you've finished that, you apply for jobs. You apply for faculty positions or postdoctoral fellowships, more often is the case now, interviewing and perhaps giving talks at universities, which are basically callbacks from the original audition at MLA. Schools typically want to see publications, conference presentations, and teaching experience in your CV, in addition to having good letters of recommendation from your advisors, an excellent writing sample from your dissertation, and a teaching portfolio. This information part is almost over, I promise. So, speaking of teaching, typically as part of your funding package, you will be assigned to TA or to teach writing courses or literature courses throughout the years. The teaching load varies from institution to institution based on departmental funding and student enrollment. Stanford is is an unusual case because as it's such a tech mecca, we have a relatively low enrollment in the humanities, which makes for less students, which makes for less classes, which then go to professors, so then we don't have as much teaching opportunities. So students are clamoring for opportunities to teach rather than being overburdened of it, as they are, say, at Berkeley. So far, as Kristen mentioned, I have taught a self-designed writing and rhetoric course for 2 quarters, participated in a teaching exchange that allowed me to teach at City College of New York for a semester, and I've TA'd for a class, and then I do a lot of tutoring on the side. All right, so now we talked about what grad school is, let's talk about some of the truly great things about it. All right, first, free food. At least at Stanford, grad school comes with a lot of free food, endless catered lunches and leftovers from such in the department fridge. If you're willing to sit through an hour of esoteric discussion twice a day, you could have every meal covered. And I'm only half joking. I remember eating glorious Mediterranean food and while listening to a discussion of Silver Age comics my first month there and thinking, you know, grad school isn't that bad. But more importantly, all of a sudden, you have time to focus on what you love. English becomes your only class, so you get to read and talk about books all day. This seems obvious, but that being said, after a while, you do start to get sick of reading all the time, but then you have to remember that other people are working while you're sitting under a tree reading Moby Dick. So, you know, there are lots of benefits. And with this time to do reading, research becomes more and more real. It feels concrete. As a grad student, you might actually meet the scholars against whom you argue in your papers. Or as is the case with contemporary fiction, you might meet the authors that you're writing about. Papers are no longer academic exercises used to show your chops. For example, the scholar whose work I've used as a touchstone for my writing sample is now my advisor. It's a little frightening, but also exhilarating. It makes the work we do seem much more like work and less like intellectual play, which is rewarding, especially if you spend a decade of your life learning how to do it. The intellectual community you can build at grad school is also unparalleled. Just within my cohort and department, I've met such interesting, bright, and innovative scholars, and they are all just as nerdy about English as I am. I distinctly remember making a joke about W.B. Yeats my first year that is so pretentious, I will not even repeat it, but my friends laughed uproariously, and that would have happened literally nowhere else. But beyond the conversations you have in coursework and in the grad lounge, a haven of secrets, old couches, leftover refreshments, and perpetually jammed printers, there are so many other networking opportunities across campus. For the last 4 years, for example, I've helped to lead a research group, the one that Kristen mentioned, Interdisciplinary Perspectives on the Contemporary, first through the Stanford Humanities Center and then through the Department of Literature, Cultures, and Languages. We bring together faculty and graduate students who are working on the contemporary from all across the humanities in order to discuss relevant criticism, share works in progress, and fly in renowned scholars in the field to give lectures and workshops. As part of this group, I've attended talks by and have had dinner with international visual artists and scholars like Amy Hungerford, Philip Wegner, Paul Rabinow, Amy Elias, Pedro Erber, Henry Jenkins, Marta Figlerowitz, and Alana Gomel, among others. It's intellectually invigorating to be able to hear really smart people talk about what you're interested in. And that's grad school in a nutshell. And last, teaching. Perhaps the thing I appreciated most about Stanford is the teaching experiences it's provided me with, few though they may be. As I mentioned earlier, I taught writing and rhetoric at Stanford, which was a wonderful experience. My course was entitled Plugged In, the Rhetoric of Networks, in order to appeal to the techie Stanford crowd. And we talked about the rhetorical choices at play in conspiracy theory, surveillance culture, social media, and fandom. There's a thrill in being able to make an impact in someone's life that's so immediate and drastic as teaching them basic writing and argumentation skills. Learning how to express yourself and to make an argument is something that will impact your students for the rest of their lives, whether or not they remember you and the memes you showed in class to try to make yourself seem fun. Later on, when I taught World Humanities at City College of New York, I engaged with a very different student population, which is part of the reason I went for the program. From the Stanford undergrads who were college prepped from the womb, I moved to a class in which many were first-generation college students and or had immigrant parents. The group was incredibly diverse, with students from Trinidad, Poland, Japan, Korea, China, Egypt, Kosovo, and more. For this reason, many of the texts we read from the Western canon, the Odyssey, King Lear, Oedipus Rex, were completely new to them. When my students finished the Odyssey, a number of them came into class completely shocked, exclaiming, "I was sure Odysseus was gonna die, or at least Telemachus." Another one of my students told me in office hours that he was reading Julius Caesar in another class, and that he was stunned when Brutus betrayed Caesar. I couldn't believe it, he told me. They must have had been secret lovers beforehand or something, and something went south. Seeing these classic texts through fresh eyes was such a joy and reminded me of the wonder that can accompany reading. So working with students on the fundamentals of writing and introducing them to new cultural experiences has led me back to my love of pedagogy and my interest in working to further secondary public education, actually. Freshmen came to my classes with vastly different levels of preparation, and seeing this has rekindled my desire to go back further in the educational timeline to get right down to the basics, so much so that I'm considering getting a master's degree in education after my PhD and returning to secondary ed in public schools. Some things never change, I guess. All right, so on to the cons. Let's get real. While graduate school can be a wonderful place to incubate ideas, grow as a scholar, learn to teach, and build a community, it can also be immensely difficult. And I don't just mean the courses, but the experience itself. I would be lying if I said that grad school had been a smooth ride for me. It was especially rough at the beginning. As a PhD program is quite the commitment, and the positives seem self-evident, I want to be candid about a few of the potential pitfalls of graduate work. First, unforeseen occurrences. No matter how much research you do into a school's program, and particularly the faculty with whom you imagine working, you really can't predict what will happen. Some faculty are unexpectedly denied tenure. Others move to another university to progress their career. Others retire. We've had 8 English department faculty who have left since I've been at Stanford or are preparing to leave this year for a combination of these reasons. Such organization wreaks havoc on your ability to form a committee of professors to for your orals exam and dissertation. So it's something to think about. And even when professors stay, you may not be able to work with them for a number of other reasons. They might be on sabbatical or leave the country for a year, or they might not be offering grad courses that are of any scholarly interest to you, or they are, but the times conflict, or worse, they don't offer courses at all during the period that you're taking coursework. For this reason, if you go to grad school, I would recommend getting to know all of the faculty in your given field at your institution. I was shy and contented myself with getting to know only those faculty whose interests seemed most in line with mine. But things happen, and it's always good to have backups. And sometimes, all of your plans simply fall into the void of chance, like when the orals exam, for which you've studied all year is rescheduled 30 minutes before it was supposed to happen, and you have to watch 6 hours of television to drain the adrenaline that was racing through your body for the 24 hours prior, and then do it all again 3 weeks later. So a graduate program is always going to be a little bit of a leap into the dark. Nothing remains completely constant over 6 years. If you've read a lot of academic satire or are a fan of black comedy, it will serve you well. Now for more personal concerns. Time management. In many ways, I feel much more freedom in grad school, especially since I moved from the semi-structured years of coursework to the blank slate of the research phase. But until you're actually faced with it, I think it's impossible to imagine the weight of unstructured work time. I've always worked best with externally imposed deadlines and assignments, so I knew that it would be tough for me to be independently focused and self-disciplined. But it has been really, really tough. And it's also been a struggle for people I know to be incredibly self-willed. It's just hard to remain focused and motivated and working all day, every day by yourself. And ideas take time to gestate, so you can't just expect to sit down and write straight gold for your dissertation 8 hours a day. A lot of it is sitting, a lot of it is thinking, and you feel as if you've produced nothing. So you can easily fall into a cycle. You feel guilty about not using your time well, and then you feel bad that your guilt caused you to sulk and waste more time. Then you feel bad about having such a first world problem in the first place as being able to sit and think all day and be paid to do it. And worse, that you can't seem to solve the issue, which leads to more procrastination and the cycle starts over. It's draining, and it's grad school. So next, potential loss of self. It's easy to lose your sense of self divorced from your work. Even when you combat the guilt and are able to do work, that can be a struggle in itself. Graduate school lends itself towards all-consuming study. The more you read, the more you find out you need to read. You check out endless books from the library. And as we all know it, a paper is never truly done, it's only due. It's easy to let this take over your life, especially if you're someone who has a sort of all or nothing attitude I demonstrated in undergrad. I remember that during my first Thanksgiving at Stanford, during which I stayed in California to work on papers rather than go home, I was reading an article about Alison Bechdel's Fun Home when I suddenly wondered, what are my hobbies? I used to have so many. I was a runner, I played the flute and piano, I made jewelry, I painted, I wrote fiction, put on amateur theatricals. One of my friends in high school once said to me, I don't think I care about one thing as much as you care about so many things. And what did I do in grad school? I studied, I worried, and I watched Project Runway to wind down. I had become so completely focused that I had stripped the life out of my life. And that, let me tell you, is not only miserable, it's also not productive for good work. We are human beings and we need balance, which is why I now have friends and do so much baking. Okay, I just wanted an excuse to show that cake. It was delicious. All right. So, along with your sense of self-worth is also sometimes precarious. Intellectual work is deeply personal, especially when you're working with philosophical ideas and concepts, as we humanities scholars often do. When you receive criticism on your use of them, it can feel as if your very ability to think is called into question. It's easy to feel essentialized by those comments, especially when not all feedback you receive will be, let's say, pedagogically useful. As a result, you can begin to equate your writing output with your ability as a scholar. Your ability as a scholar with your worth as an intellectual person, and your worth as an intellectual person as your worth as a person, period. When I started graduate school, I tried to put a finger on what was different about my experiences with the department there and the one here. And while a part of it is no doubt the increased rigor associated with graduate work opposed to undergraduate work, I also think there's a slight difference of affect. It wasn't that professors at Stanford were not generous and encouraging and constructively critical, though that wasn't always the case. But at BYU, there's a sense that you are first and foremost a human being, a child of God. And that in itself somewhat imperceptibly changes the general way professors interact with you, in my experience. You're not just a student, you're a person, and you have worth beyond your studies. I've not always had the best experience with professors in grad school, which for an incorrigible teacher's pet like myself was in itself somewhat of a shock. But even with the nicest professors in grad school, it's easy to feel like you are first and foremost not a person, but a brain. And if that brain doesn't seem to be functioning properly, that's devastating. So, last point. All of these things, the guilt that comes out of inevitably poorly managed time, the potential loss of self, and the questioning of self-worth, can lead to mental health concerns. In a cohort meeting with the chair of grad studies during my fourth year, when we were all trying to figure out what our project was, one person was dancing around the subject of why she hadn't made much recent progress and ended up impulsively admitting that she had experienced some mental health issues that had halted her work. Then, surprisingly, three or four other people then also admitted to experiencing some form of anxiety or depression that had affected their research. It was as if a release valve had been turned. Once someone broke the silence, it was okay for us to admit that this is something that happens. I talked to several people after that meeting who expressed how relieved they were when it was finally brought up. So, such psychological trauma forms what is often referred to as the imposter syndrome. So on to section 3, out imposter. This is the feeling that you're not good enough, that you were the mistake, they let you in by accident, that you don't belong, and that sooner or later everyone else is going to realize that you're a fraud. This is an experience so common that it's only barely hyperbolic to say that I've received at least one email a month from Stanford which references it or promotes a workshop combating it. It's all over the place. Graduate school, especially at top 10 schools, is a concentration of the sharpest, most committed people in your field. By design, you go from being a relatively big fish in a small pond to just another guppy flailing around. Just when you feel like you've gained some ground, you've graduated, for goodness sakes, you go back to being a freshman and surrounded by the most brilliant people you can imagine. The feelings of inadequacy you face can affect your ability to focus, to work, to have the confidence to speak up in seminars or present papers at conferences, to believe that you can create a project worth pursuing. This was definitely true for me, and I think it was exacerbated by a couple of additional factors that made me feel out of place, which is why I now present to you the Kirkwood Guide to Sticking Out in Grad School. First off, have pink hair. This one's on me. I underestimated the preppiness of Silicon Valley. Berkeley in 1968, Palo Alto in 2012 was not. But hey, I just graduated from BYU, so what was I waiting for? yeah, that was interesting. And then number two, start young. I was so sure that a PhD was what I wanted that I just went for it straight out of the gate, starting the fall after my senior year. This has been beneficial in some ways, not the least of which being that I'll finish before I'm 30. But I also feel like I could have used some seasoning, some more life experience before dedicating myself to such a deep commitment. I was enthusiastic and eager to please, but also slightly naive and impetuous, a difficult combination. I was trying my best, but I was young. And it didn't help that in grad school, you have colleagues of all different levels of experience. A few in my cohort had come straight through, as I did, but they were the minority. Many worked before graduating in journalism, in teaching, in publishing, before returning to school. And many others had earned master's degrees at other institutions prior to starting the PhD program. Made me feel good in some ways that I was able to, like, you know, hang in with them. But I also felt pretty small, and it heightened my intellectual insecurity. So, number three, be religious. I mention this because it was one of the first characteristics that was attached to me at Stanford. Towards the end of my application, I was surprised to find a section asking for a statement as to how your admission would help increase the diversity of the school. As a middle-class white American girl, I didn't feel as I had much to offer in the diversity department. But I knew that being religious in a secular field did make me a minority of sorts, and I thought that as my BYU affiliation already declared my Mormondom, I might as well acknowledge it. So I quickly jotted something down about my religious affiliation in the most jovial and non-threatening way possible, referring to myself as a hippie Mormon, trying to tie together old world and new world in cutesy statements like, I read the Bible and the New York Times. It was a paragraph, and I thought no one would read it closely, but they did. And when I arrived for my admissions visit and mentioned my name, current grad students and faculty alike said with recognition, oh, so you're the hippie Mormon. I was outed, which wasn't a problem, but it became clear quickly that the reason it was so notable was not that I was the only Mormon. We now have one more in our department. Yay, Trent! but that was that I was the only religious person in my department. And now I had an awesome moniker to help people remember that. In general, the Academy is not heavily religious. And in my experience, literary studies is particularly secular in outlook. It can be easy to forget that at BYU, or at least difficult to grasp what being such in such an environment would be like. There are some cultural differences. I don't drink the wine that is an obligatory part of any department event. And I stopped going to the weekly happy hour at the local dive bar after my first year. I was sick of drinking soda and eating mediocre quesadillas. I really wish they had like chocolate or cookies or sundaes, but bars don't do that. but especially since I'm a Democrat, it wasn't so much the culture that bothered me. During the recent California presidential election, I was asked in the grad lounge, who are you voting for? By someone who was trying to decide whether to vote for Hillary or Bernie, because those were the only two options. Like, they are. And that was, and I felt the same way, so it wasn't a problem. A word of caution to any Republicans looking at grad school in the liberal arts, just good luck with that. What really made me feel out of place was the subtle anti-religious tone that I at least intuited in academic culture. Not particularly like my institution, but across the board. My senior year at BYU, I took Dr. Muhlstein's literary theory class, and he went to great pains to help us reconcile, or rather integrate our faith and our studies. He wanted us to be able to work with the ideas of Marx and Althusser without necessarily agreeing with the idea that religion is the opiate of the masses or that we're being hailed into an oppressive system without choice. And while I appreciated his concern, I kept thinking, all right, man, we get it. I'm not gonna lose my faith because I read critical theory. But when I started work at a more secular institution at which many of the concepts of organized religion are seen as illogical or naive, if not downright oppressive or bigoted, it was good to have thought about it, to be prepared to defend my belief system, if only to myself privately. For though I haven't experienced much personally pointed antagonism against my beliefs or lifestyle, although I did start during the Romney campaign and election, that was fun, there is a sense in the atmosphere that serious intellectuals do not believe such nonsense. This is no doubt in part a personal projection, but still contributes to the feeling of being out of place. My diversity statement was more true than I knew at the time. The humanities and religion are not inherently opposed, just as the sciences and religion are not. It is we who, in our limited understanding, put up walls of opposition. I find healthy challenges to be enriching and in strengthening to my faith, as it keeps me constantly engaged in studying and affirming my ideas and remembering that there is much, much more to the world than my ward. But at times, it can feel difficult and lonely. And if you really want to feel like your work is insignificant, study the humanities in Silicon Valley. Stanford actually has an amazing program in the liberal arts. I wouldn't have chosen to attend if that wasn't the case. But it is true that we are very, very marginal to campus culture. In 1959, in a controversial and much discussed lecture that was later published as The Two Cultures and the Scientific Revolution, C.P. Snow set in motion a lively debate about the divide between the humanities and the sciences, or what he referred to as the two cultures. According to Snow, traditional intellectual culture had neglected the sciences to the detriment of progress. 50-odd years later, and it's remarkable to think that that may have once been the case or thought to have been the case, two cultures definitely still exist, but the locus of power and authority is flipped. In the face of the tech boom of recent decades, the place of the humanities seems increasingly precarious, and this is true no more, this, blah. And nowhere is this more true than in the heart of Silicon Valley. At Stanford, the divide between STEM fields and the humanities and social sciences is given a near official vocabulary. You're either a techie or, an endearingly patronizing term, a fuzzy. And the techies come out in force. According to Deborah Satz, Senior Associate Dean for the Humanities and the Humanities and the Arts, humanities enrollment has been in steady decline since the 1960s and 70s at Stanford, with only 17% of Stanford students majoring in the humanities. And in my experience, nearly all students, regardless of major, see taking the introductory CS courses as a given, an unspoken requirement for general education. And hearing chatter across campus, you would think that problem sets or P sets are the only kind of assignment imaginable. This is hardly surprising, with buildings named after Hewlett, Packard, and Gates, and cradled in an upper-class suburb teeming with startups and well-established giants in the tech industry, Facebook, Google, Apple, Snapchat, Dropbox. It's no wonder that techies come here in droves. There is a side effect, however, of an implicit devaluation of humanities departments, who as a result have to fight to attract students in order to justify their existence. In an email to the Stanford Daily, the former chair of my department, Gavin Jones, admitted that he's seen firsthand the kind of culture that quickly develops, the peer and parental pressure that pushes students into vocational majors. I've definitely succumbed to this feeling. There are, of course, humanists on campus, and I find my community inspiring and thought-provoking, but in my ward, outside, and even on campus, technology is king. Over time, I started to take for granted that most people didn't really care about what I did, so I wouldn't talk about it. And then I began to fall into what is often referred to as the CS vortex, wondering why I hadn't ever bothered to learn computer coding. How did I let myself become technologically, that is to say, functionally illiterate? This despite my complete lack of interest in tech. The gravitational pull towards the sciences isn't as strong everywhere as it is in Palo Alto, but I think it makes visible a dangerous trend in society at large. Just last week, for example, President Trump released a budget proposal that suggests completely eliminating the National Endowment for the Humanities and the Arts, as well as slashing all funding for the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, making him the first president to do so. But rather than taking these indications as a death toll for our studies, I like to think of it as evidence of the vital importance of what we do. Moving to part four, time for idealism, why the humanities are more important than ever. C.P. Snow argued that a boundless humanities without regard for scientific progress was counterproductive, and now I'll argue that the inverse is true. A focus on industry and progress untethered from humanistic inquiry is not only counterproductive, but dangerous. The humanities serve many purposes, preserving a history of our culture, providing an outlet and opportunities for aesthetic pleasure, teaching empathy, but the most important purpose of the humanities, as I see it, is to foster and promote literate discourse. Our job is to learn and to teach others how to think critically, not only to read for literal meaning, but for subtext, tone, and argument. And in discussing these readings, we learn not only to express ourselves cogently and effectively, but to engage respectfully and productively with the ideas of others. In writing and in speech, our work is that of conversation, of deep inquiry across lines of difference. And when, regardless of your political background, has that ability been more vital than it is now? I'm not saying this because I need a fiery, inspirational conclusion to my talk. This is something I've really come to believe. In my undergrad, I gave all sorts of reasons to justify my choice to study English, but it wasn't until recently that I've come to truly value the skills that we learn and teach. And I'm not talking for job prospects, but for life and for the future of our country. Google does good work, and they have a great cafeteria and colorful bikes that you can ride all around campus. But if we all fled to tech, then where would that leave us? So, conclusion, practical matters, a coda. All right, so let's be frank. I'm not going to say that we should all altruistically study the humanities for the sheer good of public citizenry. We also have to make money to live. And this is another arena in which my thinking has changed. As I mentioned earlier, the choices I saw for myself as an English major were limited. Teaching, writing, law school. These are all good professions and probably the ones that are best suited to my personality and skill sets. But they are not the only options. There are many possible applications for a humanities degree. You just might need to be a little bit more creative. I know people who have used their degrees not just to teach or be librarians, but to go into comedy, to do technical writing for businesses, to work in marketing, become archivists for museums, to work in ed tech companies, to make flowcharts about pop culture for data visualization companies, and become editors for statistic journals. The options are endless if you, one, have the guts to pursue what you want, and two, branch out early. The one thing I wish I had done differently in college was diversify my education and work portfolio. I'm telling you this as someone with a one-track mind. You change as life goes on, so look at different avenues for your abilities. You might find later that you want to pursue them, and it's good to have a foot in the door. And have confidence. Put your writing online, do stand-up comedy, get an internship at a company you like doing whatever. Work for an ed tech startup, do journalism, be a paralegal for the summer. Do anything that you think you might have a slight interest in. The more experience and contacts you make, the better. And it's possible. So I'll add an addendum to Wickman's mantra. Don't go to grad school if you can imagine being happy doing literally anything else. And even if you think you know exactly what you want to do, try something else first. If at the end of everything you still want to go to the grad school, then welcome to the club. Thank you. Are we going? What? I'm open for questions, I guess.
So if you need to leave to run to a class, you can run to your class. But if you'd like to stay for a few minutes and ask questions, raise your hand.
I talked at a breakneck speed for 50 minutes, so I doubt that there are any questions, but it's fine. Oh, yes. Why a writing and rhetoric course? So that was part of the way that our institution was set up. All graduate students in English used to be the teachers for what the equivalent of would be writing 150 here, I think. And so we were, that was just what was given to us. Since then, my cohort was actually the last cohort to teach that because the rhetoric people got up in arms about how rhetoric is not English and they wanted to have more science people teaching. So after my year, I felt really lucky because I was able to teach that and it was really fun. So thanks. Yes? Ah, yeah, okay. So what was my area of focus when I entered grad school and did it change? It changed somewhat. I came in I was doing contemporary American lit, but I used to do more Cold War stuff along the Dr. Matthews front. That sort of shifted partially because of the professors that were at Stanford. There was more happening with the more contemporary work, and so as I became involved with those professors and in those classes, then I got more interested in that section. I think that sometimes your focus does change based on the people that you meet, so thanks. Rachel Gilman. Yes, as it's meant to be.
So I appreciate the candidness, but what would you say to someone like me who's looking at the new administration, looking at the future of humanities in general, but someone who feels very passionate about, I say passionate, but who's also dedicated to teaching and what you describe as the journey of an academic?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's a good question. So why pursue a PhD in this climate? So one thing that I would say is if you're thinking about doing a PhD and you're not sure, then doing a master's is a good thing to start with to get your feet wet, see if you like it, which I know that you've done. But I think that, even while the humanities are facing underfunding and all of that, they're always going to exist in some form or another, and we're going to need really passionate people. And so if you feel deeply committed and able to weather the storm, then I'd say go for it. Knowing, though, that the job market is very tough right now. So most people going on the market go on for a few years before they're able to get a position at a school. So I know brilliant people in my department, brilliant people who had publications and all sorts of things got no bites last year, and so are looking at a lot of postdocs, a lot of interim lectureships. So you have to be patient, and that's something that was really good to know going in. That's a good question. I was always I'm like a very by the book kind of person. So I was 4 years is college. I'm gonna be done in 4 years. So I don't know if I would have spent more time, but I do think that minors is one thing I wish I had done. I thought about getting an editing minor, but then didn't. I almost did a French minor and then bailed on that when I got into classes with a lot of return missionaries who thought they were quite something for being called to France. But then I So and then I fell into women's studies courses, and I loved that. So I did a minor in women's studies. But I do think that finding, and especially if you're studying English, finding a really instrumental minor is a good thing. Like editing, something that has concrete skills that are attached to it that you can apply directly to the job market. Because English, while it provides you with great critical thinking skills and all of these things, you do have to kind of finagle your way into a lot of jobs, because people don't automatically see English and say, ah, I want them. Maybe some do, but not all will. So you have to sell yourself a lot more. So thinking about double majors or minors is a really good thing to do. Yeah. Back. I'll get to you in a minute. Yeah, no, I think that's fine. Interdisciplinary work is very encouraged nowadays, and there are actually programs which do this specifically. At Stanford, there's a program called Modern Thought and Literature, which is all about putting things together. And I know someone who got, what did he get? His undergrad in medieval studies, he got a master's in anthropology, and then another master's in something, and then decided to do a PhD in literature. So there are some people who just collect degrees. I don't have the stamina for that. But I think that's one really great way, if you're really interested in interdisciplinary work, to do that, is getting the training in both areas. So I don't think there's anything wrong with it. And did you have another question?
Set jobs, and I think most of us kind of have the assumption that you get a PhD professor. Mm-hmm. That's like your one track to go. But it almost seems like you're thinking of going back to high school. Are there other kind of job opportunities that we're not aware of that come with a PhD?
I'd say yes and no. I personally think that you shouldn't go into a PhD unless you're pretty dang sure that you want to be in the academy, because it's a lot to commit to. And the PhD really prepares you for that. That's what its job is. If you're thinking about doing other things, there's other ways to do it. That said, there are what they're calling alt-ac, alternate academia or alternatives to academia jobs, especially in this climate where there are so few jobs. There's always workshops being held at Stanford like, look, you can be a subject librarian, or you can do this and such. And so there aren't very many. The thing that I'm thinking about is more of I'm taking a circuitous path. I wanted to learn a lot more about English, and I did. And now I just feel really committed to teaching, and I'm still not sure how that's going to work out. But I always knew, personally, that I probably wouldn't be a professor for my entire life. I wanted to work in ed tech, making interesting curriculum. I wanted to write. I wanted to do a lot of things. I'm a person who has a lot of different goals. So for me, I wasn't looking for a lifelong career. I was kind of thinking in stages. But that's a personal thing. So yeah, don't go if you. If you don't want to be a professor. So. Oh, okay, one more. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, a lot of discipline. I find it's easier to be disciplined with reading than with just, like, thinking about ideas. So just making sure that you make a rigid reading schedule for yourself about, like, okay, I have this class on this day, so I'm going to make sure to do that reading for on these certain days, like just chunking up your time. That's really the only way to do it. And I will admit there are a couple of books that I didn't finish, because we were reading like three books for that class that week, and I wasn't going to write a paper on the mysteries of Udolpho, so I have a short list of books that I want to finish once I finish. Ones that I didn't quite get to. But I always, I mean, I'm a thorough person, so you know, you just kind of slog through.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.